Okay, so my name is Mariko Nagai. Thank you so much for coming out on Monday morning when you could be doing any other thing that's offered in Tokyo. Here you are. My name is Mariko Nagai. I'm a professor and director of research at TUJ. And I'll be moderating tonight. So the way how it's going to work out is I'll introduce Akemi. I have a little bit of introduction. I'm going to do about Okinawa for, I hope, about 10 minutes, and then I'll pass it on to Akemi. She'll talk for about 45 minutes, and then I'll have one or two questions as a prompt to get the moderation going, and then it's all yours. So I'll start with my own anecdote. Whenever I travel, and I do a lot of traveling, I never travel by driving. I always take buses and taxis. And it's simply because I get to collect stories. I'm a writer myself. And so whenever I travel, I like to be a voyeur of how people live, what kind of stories they have. So between 2016 and 2018, I was doing research in Okinawa. So I took many, many buses around Okinawan Island. For those of you who have ever been there, the buses are awful. Oftentimes, if I was staying in Naha, I wanted to go to the south of the island. It took me 4 hours to get there. A bus was every hour from Naha to Itoman, and then from Itoman to wherever I was going, that was once in 2 hours. So on these bus trips, I met people, as I was doing research, I met people like Sachiko, or Mio, or Kiki, who appears in Akemi's stories. Akemi's Night in the American Village. I met a woman who, still 75 years later, gets paralysis on her hand every April and May. And as we were talking, she said, well, I think my hand stops moving because that's the hand that held my mother's stomach as her innards were coming out during the war. I also met a woman who was born after the war, and though her mother never said it, she thinks that she's a product of rape. But her mother basically said, I don't know who your father is, we'll never talk about it. They all had stories to tell, like Akemi's, woman that Akemi met on her journey. They told, some willingly told me their stories, some shyly, and I, because I'm a woman from Yamato, the mainland, I was sometimes welcomed, but most of the time seen with suspicion, as if to say, why are you stealing our stories? So what Akemi has done in this book is phenomenal. She got into the lives of these women, have them open up to talk about their very intimate stories about from their life. Though I'm not an expert in Okinawa, this is what I can tell you, and as I think Akemi will tell you as well. Okinawa is a space of many layers, often contradictions. It is a multiple space, it's a space of multiple contact zones. Contact zone between the United States and Japan, between Japan and Okinawa, between the history of colonization and occupation. It's also a contested space, different parties all jostling for what it is. When I talk to an American military personnel, they all say how much they love Okinawa. When I talk to Japanese mainlanders, they'll say, oh, Okinawa is so spiritual. And every time I go there, I feel so much better. When you talk to Okinawans, once again, it's layered. And maybe it's too many layers. As you may know, Okinawa had, for the longest time, the highest unemployment rate in Japan. 7 to 8%, though it's getting somewhat better. It also has the highest birth rate, but the lowest number of children graduate from high school, and also ranked the bottom for college bound. It has, surprisingly, the highest rate of male suicide in Japan, but it also has the lowest female suicide rate. So imagine that. And as you know, it also houses more than 70% of American basis. So I want to sort of share with you an anecdote that I had. On one of my many bus trips in Okinawa, I was going from Itoman to a southern tip because that was where the mass suicide was. And so I got on the bus. I was the only person there. I got off the bus, And the bus driver kind of looked at me and said, oh, where are you going? And I said, oh, I'm going to this cliff about 3 kilometers away from here. And he was like, oh, okay. And then I saw that the next bus was going to be 2 hours later. So I went quickly, came back. The bus was waiting, a different bus driver. And he looked at me and said, oh, we were kind of getting worried about you. You know, you're a single woman, suicide cliff. And, you know, and this is what struck me. He said, Okinawans don't go there because that place is haunted. And I thought, oh. And once again, by the way, this is me, the only person on the bus. And we started talking. When he found out that I wasn't there for, like, mostly mainlander for a spiritual reason, but because I was doing research, he relaxed and he said, and so we started talking, and I think he sort of embodies the complexities of Okinawa. He talked about his war. He was from a family of 25 or so, and by the time the war ended, it was only him and his sister who survived. He was about 3 or 4. He also talked about the Korean and Vietnam wars that he went through, ghosts that he's seen. He also worked in Tokyo. He needed to come back to Okinawa in 1972. And he also said how he doesn't mind the basis because, quote, that's what my family members do. They all work in basis. But he's also had some very conflicted feelings about it because the village that he used to live in, his family used to live in, is inside the base, so he can never go home. He also said that he hates that Okinawa makes money off of the dead, the war memory. But at the same time, without the tourism, Okinawa can't exist. He also said that his daughter married an American, and he didn't talk to her for a couple years because he was frightened, angry. But then it turns out that his son-in-law is the best thing that ever happened to him. And that complexity is, I think, kind of embodied in the characters in your book as well, that there, it's not just one story, but it's all multi-generational. And it is a rare book, by the way, to come across any book about Okinawa that can actually attack both the contemporary issues as well as the historical. Because oftentimes when books about Okinawa comes out, it's very one-dimensional. It's Okinawa as a healing space, whether it's mainland books, or whether it's Okinawa as a part of violence, Okinawa as a battleground, Okinawa as an orphan state, Okinawa as an occupied state. But these are just mostly done in a very isolated thematic way. So what Akemi has done is, I don't know, I can only bow to it for the feat you have done. Her book is a complex book. It doesn't say what is right, what's wrong. I think it offers the gray area, the contact zone, where anything can happen. And it's as much as book is complex, so are the lives of these women that appears in her book. And I just want to sort of share with you, before I turn it to Akemi, what she writes in the book. And this is from the end. There is so much I wanted to say about Okinawa, about its history and injustices and beauty, but we were gazing at the sailboats and making polite talk over shrimp. To have him understand, I needed to tell him the whole story. I needed to bring to life the people I had met there, the woman in dialogue with two of the world's superpowers, the ones telling truth others don't want to hear. And Akemi Johnson does precisely this, tell the truth others don't want to hear in her book, Night in the American Village.
Well, thank you so much for that. And I'm so impressed you took the bus around Okinawa because I know how long that takes. it really is a bad bus system. Yeah. So I'm so happy to be here, and I'm so grateful to all of you for coming out tonight, and to Ana East for organizing this. So this is my first book event in Japan, and I'm really excited. We just flew in this morning, so I hope I'm coherent. But I've been doing these book talks in the United States so far, and you know, when I'm there, I have to show people where Okinawa is on a map, right? That's where I'm starting from. So I'm guessing you all know quite a bit more about Okinawa, and I'm really looking forward to hearing from you after this and any comments or questions from you all. I'm just curious, like, who here has been to Okinawa before? Okay, yeah, so quite a few. So some of what I talk about you might already know, but I'm going to kind of just cover different areas of my book, and there's a lot more in here. And I wanted to start just by telling you a little bit about myself and where I'm coming from. I am from California, and my father is white American. My mother is Japanese American, third generation Sansei, so I'm Yonsei. And it was her grandparents, my great-grandparents, who immigrated to California from the Hiroshima region in around 1920. And I, growing up in California, I wasn't living in an area that was very diverse. And so when I was growing up, I really kind of had a conflicted relationship with my Japanese identity. I didn't want to be Japanese. I wanted to be like everyone else. I did not like my first name, which is Japanese, and I really, you know, didn't want to be associated with Japan, even a place that I really didn't know much about at all. That started to change for me when I went to college. I went to Brown on the East Coast of the United States, and that's when I kind of dove into my Japanese identity. I started studying Japanese, and I decided to spend my junior year in Kyoto, studying abroad. And I got to Kyoto. It's a beautiful city, right? And there's so much I loved about it. But I think I had this experience that I think is common for a lot of people, where in the U.S. I often describe myself as Japanese, right? I'm half Japanese. My name is Japanese. But in Japan, I found that people saw me as American, right? I'm not Japanese anymore. And so, you know, my Japanese name, which no one could pronounce in the U.S., I found in Japan, I couldn't even say it correctly so that people could understand me. And when I would introduce myself, people would say, you know, oh, that's a difficult name. Is it Candy? You know, like, no, it's Japanese. So when I first went to Okinawa, which during that year in Kyoto, I found that right away it was, you know, a very different place than the parts of Japan I had seen on the mainland. Right, as you all, many of you know, right, you've been there, there's, of course, the subtropical climate, there's those white sand beaches, you know, gorgeous blue water, there's the Okinawan culture, history, language that's there, and then there are all these U.S. military bases. So here I brought this map of Okinawa Island with all the U.S. military bases labeled there, so you can see, right? Of course, we know Okinawa is a very small part of Japan. It's less than 1% of the landmass, but I think now it's about 64% of the land used by U.S. military bases in Japan is in Okinawa, and they're mostly crowded on this main island. There's about half of the 54,000 American troops in Japan are in Okinawa, and the majority of those are Marines, with about 18,000 Marines in Okinawa. So especially when you're in the central part of this island, as you can see, that's where the bases are concentrated. You really feel their presence when you're there. You'll often see the fences topped with barbed wire. And, you know, off base in Okinawa, in these areas, it's very crowded. It's, you know, finite space, a lot of concrete, a lot of traffic. And then you look through the fences on base, and it's just these wide green lawns, not a lot of buildings, not a lot of traffic. So it's really, it feels like night and day. And I think, you know, like many people before I had gone to Okinawa, what I had heard about it was the anti-base protest against, you know, protests against these bases. And so when I went there, I expected to encounter that, and I expected to find, you know, see people with the no base signs and maybe even feel some anti-American sentiment when I was there. But, you know, and while there is a very strong resistance movement in Okinawa, which I'm going to talk about, I was surprised, as Professor Nogai was talking about, you know, when I was there, I found that many people I met had a much more ambivalent stance toward the base presence. For them, the base issue was very complicated and tied up with their own personal experiences and really intimate issues. It was much more complex than I think the story we often hear, which is rather simplistic pro-base, anti-base stories. So, and that was surprising, and then maybe more surprising to me was that I found I felt a very strong personal connection to this place as well. I don't have any ties to the US military myself. My family is not from Okinawa, but especially in these areas around the US military bases, there was something that felt familiar to me, and it was this mix of cultures and people. And as Professor Nagai mentioned, some academics might call this a contact zone, where ideologies and cultures and politics collide. And as a mixed race person, I've recognized something in this mixture. And it wasn't a place I felt like I could really belong, but it was a place that I felt like there was more space for someone like me, especially compared to the other parts of Japan I had visited and even parts of the United States too. So after that first trip to Okinawa, I kept going back, and I lived there for a year doing research for this book on a Fulbright grant, and then I spent some time there more recently. And I started researching the history of Okinawa and collecting people's stories. And one of the goals of this book is to tell a different kind of story about Okinawa, one I hadn't really heard before. And a lot of the stories I had heard from Okinawa, Okinawans were cast as victims of the US and Japan, but you know, people I met there, many of them did not seem to see themselves as victims. And many instead were choosing to actively engage with the US military presence in some way. They had agency, and with their actions, they could either help the bases remain where they are, or they could, with their actions, challenge this whole system and, by extension, the US-Japan Security Alliance. So I started collecting stories from people that represent a range of experiences, and I focused on women because they are arguably the most affected by this base presence, because they're the ones more likely to date and marry US service members, to work in the entertainment areas around the bases, and to be the targets of sexual assault. So before I go into some of these women's stories, I wanted to just speak briefly about the history of Okinawa, although I'm sure many of you already know it, and there's much more in my book. But as many of you know, right, historically Okinawa was separate from Japan. It was an independent kingdom called the Ryukyu Kingdom. And centuries ago, the Ryukyu people leveraged their central location to become a thriving civilization built around international trade, so namely the transoceanic trade of luxury goods. But the same central location that made people successful at trading also attracted larger powers that wanted that prime real estate. And so in the late 1800s, Japan overthrew the king of the Ryukyus and annexed the islands as a prefecture. And it was after that that Okinawans were pressured to assimilate and lose their culture and language and become Japanese. And so one example of how this happened is that in schools in Okinawa, kids had to wear this sign of shame if you were caught speaking the Okinawan language. And the only way you could get rid of that sign was to catch another student in the act of speaking the language, and then you could pass off the sign to the other student. So it was this kind of self-policing that came about, and that went up to adults as well. There's a local newspaper in Okinawa wrote an editorial that said, "We must even sneeze as the Japanese do." So by the time World War II came, many Okinawans considered themselves Japanese. And like all citizens in Japan at that time, they were mobilized to fight in this war. Everyone from children to the elderly were trained to fight and protect the homeland. And You know, Okinawans soon had to use this training, right, because Okinawa was the only place in Japan to experience a ground battle during the war. On April 1st, 1945, the U.S. invaded Okinawa, and for the next almost 3 months, war raged across the island, and it was one of the bloodiest battles of the Pacific War, claiming the lives of thousands of Japanese and American troops. But the highest loss of life was among Okinawan civilians, with as many as 140,000 Okinawans dying, which was about one-third of the population, so one in three people. And you know, many of these deaths occurred on the battlefield. You know, Okinawans were caught in the crossfire between American and Japanese troops. Others died from starvation or lack of medical aid. Some died at the hands of American soldiers, and some died at the hands of Japanese soldiers. And this is, you know, controversial topics for some, but, you know, Okinawans tell us that even though they consider themselves Japanese at this point, and then they were willing to die for Japan, many Japanese soldiers still saw them as the other and not Japanese, and sometimes saw them as spies or being disloyal to Japan. And there are accounts of Japanese soldiers kicking Okinawans out of their hiding places in the war, taking their food, executing them, and pressuring or forcing them to commit suicide. As you mentioned, these groups, so it's suicides. They told Okinawans that the Americans were devil beasts who would, you know, rape, murder, torture Okinawans, and so the more honorable route to take was to commit suicide. And I think maybe, you know, the most haunting part of that battle for me, at least, is these group suicides where whole families were pressured to kill each other and take the lives of their loved ones. So as the battle ended, those who had survived prepared themselves to die at the hands of these devil beasts, right, the Americans' victors. And they were surprised that instead of, you know, widespread killing everyone, the Americans had a policy of providing food and medical aid to Okinawans. They set up refugee camps, which were difficult places to be in many ways, but they also saved many lives of Okinawans. And this was the start of Okinawans' complicated relationship with the U.S. military presence. So again, as I'm sure many of you know, right, the U.S. occupied all of Japan until 1952, and it was in that peace treaty that mainland Japan regained its sovereignty, but Okinawa did not, remained under the control of the United States. And it was during this time in the 1950s when the U.S. military started closing many bases on the mainland and started building them in Okinawa, where they had total control, and it was much easier to do that. Okinawans call this process by bulldozer and bayonet, because oftentimes the U.S. military forced Okinawans off their land, you know, at bayonet point, and bulldozed their houses to make these military bases. Just as happened on mainland Japan, Okinawans resisted this process, but there wasn't much they could do to stop it, because at that time they were not protected under the U.S. or Japanese constitution. They weren't citizens of either place. They lacked rights, and so there was also widespread poverty in Okinawa at that time, and by many accounts, widespread sexual violence by U.S. Soldiers during the occupation, because they did not often face any consequences for their actions. In this climate, more and more Okinawans wanted a reversion to Japan, so go back to Japan, thinking that would bring a higher standard of living and closure of these U.S. military bases. So in 1972, that movement was successful, and Okinawa became a part of Japan again. And you know, over the years, the standard of living did rise in Okinawa, though hasn't really caught up to the mainland completely with the GDP, but to many people's dismay, Okinawa, after the reversion, the bases stayed in Okinawa. So they didn't get the closure that they wanted. So when you look at this history, right, it does seem like Okinawa has had a troubled relationship with the United States, right? The U.S. invaded and many people died in that battle. The U.S. occupied Okinawa and, you know, took people's land for bases. And so I was surprised when I started spending time in Okinawa, I started noticing a certain trend on the island. And I'm going to read a little bit from my book now. So this is from a night in Okinawa when my friend, who is an American named Kate, said to me, "I want to take you to a place that's like an inside-out sock." And she led me through the entertainment district outside Kadena Air Base in Okinawa City. Kate and I turned south from the main drag. As we entered a building on a side street, Kate said, "This is either the Okinawa in America or the America in Okinawa. Same thing, I guess." The sign on the door read reverse. She pushed it open, and inside, on a brightly lit stage, was a band in American 1950s costumes. They were either locals or from mainland Japan. The female singers wore poodle skirts and beehives, and the male crooner sported a silver suit and Elvis hair. I felt like I'd entered a David Lynch movie. The song "Can't Hurry Love" began, and a dozen middle-aged local women rushed to dance in front of the stage. A white man grooved at their center. The bar area was spotted with a few more grizzled Americans. "He's probably been here since the Vietnam War," Kate said, pointing at one of them. Sipping cocktails at the bar, we watched the dance floor fill after the band broke into La Bamba. When the Richie Valens hit had come out 50 years before, the island had been under American control. The 1950s and 60s, per the history books, were a time of Okinawan poverty, racial and sexual violence, and land seizure and protest. Life under American rule had been difficult for Okinawans. But here in reverse, the bargoers swimming to surf in USA suggested a different kind of memory, a nostalgia for that time. It was Kate's inside-out sock, a story inverted to reveal a hidden, messier side. And so that wasn't the only kind of tribute to America that I started noticing around the island. I started noticing a lot of things like this that seemed to celebrate America, especially that occupation era. And I have some photos of some other things. Okay, so this is a shopping center on Okinawa, and you can see that there's like kind of a lot of imagery like this from like 1950s diners, America. This is outside a bar in Keene, and someone had painted these old American cars on benches around the bar area. This is a restaurant near the American Village, owned by this Okinawan couple who just like loved everything American, and they served pretty bad steak and pie there. This is also in the American Village. It's USA Hood Quarters. And this is kind of dark. You can see that's the American flag is painted on the building. This is in the American Village, which is kind of like, it's a shopping center, but it's kind of like a USA theme park as well. Kind of has that feel of like Disneyland USA. And this was a store there. You can see the Statue of Liberty. Inside, you can buy all this U.S. military gear. There's old U.S. military posters on the wall. Uncle Sam, and you can buy old TV guides there from and Life magazines. And this is a shot from the American Village, too. You can see probably a military family, old American license plates, and then probably some local kids hanging out there as well. So this kind of, this is just one example of the kind of tension that I was interested in my book. So is that difficult history and protest against the U.S. military presence alongside this kind of intimacy with America and also a kind of celebration of America. And so these were the kinds of tensions that I was also interested in exploring with the women who I talked to. My book is organized around 10 women who I profile, and I'm going to read the opening of one of them now called Arisa. Okay. When Arisa was a girl in the 1980s, her father devised an unusual game. He challenged her and her sister to walk all the way around Kadena Air Base with him. The family lived in Okinawa City, close enough to the base that the Japanese government paid for double-paned windows and an air conditioning unit in each room to muffle the noise of the aircraft. In her father's game, the three of them would set out from their house and begin walking along the tall fence topped with barbed wire. I think my dad wanted us to know how big Kadena Base is, Arisa said. Kadena is the biggest U.S. Air Force base in all of Asia, swallowing chunks of Chatan Town, Kadena Town, and Okinawa City. Its two runways stretched more than 2 miles each. When anti-base demonstrators joined hands in protest around the base in 1986, forming a human chain, they needed more than 20,000 bodies. Arisa, her father, and her sister would start at the northeast end of the base in Okinawa City, following the fence south through the entertainment district of bars and clubs. They'd break for lunch at an A&W, then rest again at McDonald's after reaching Route 58 in Chatan. They continued north into the town of Kadena, where residents received even higher subsidies from the Japanese government since they were closer to the runways. After 4 or 5 hours, the circle would be complete, and Arisa's father would reward his daughters with 10,000 yen bills, a considerable prize for a kid. Yeah. Arisa's parents were both busy professionals, her father an engineer, her mother an elementary school teacher. Although they didn't discuss their political views of the bases, Arisa knew her mother voted for anti-base candidates and sometimes protested outside the bases as part of a teacher's organization. The prevailing attitude at Arisa's school, too, was against the bases. Perhaps with his game, her dad was trying to engender some sense of injustice in his daughters, showing them viscerally how much land Kadena Air Base occupied. The impression on Arisa, in any case, was positive. She would remember those walks with fondness, not only because of the cash she earned, but also because of the adventure and the way they etched the base into her imagination. So I really loved the story of these little Okinawan girls who played this game of walking around this military base. You know, they were literally growing up in the shadows of this massive base, and their parents were politically against the U.S. military base presence. But this was a fun game that for Arisa, one that she remembered really positively. And Arisa went on to marry a U.S. serviceman and became someone who no longer had to circle that base, but she could go on to the base. And so when I was with Arisa, she drove me on to Kadena Air Base, and we could go into that off-limit space that she spent her childhood circling. She told me that she hadn't set out to marry an American, but she believed there were positives to being with an American, and many women in Okinawa had these ideas of American men that they shared with me. They thought they were more romantic or put ladies first, or treated women more as equals. They said they did more housework or expressed their feelings more. Those were common ideas about American men. And Arisa said she was happy with her life choices, but she felt some internal tension about this base issue. She said that she felt like her spirit was Okinawan, and she did think there should be a reduction of military bases in Okinawa, but she felt like she could never get involved in the anti-base movement because her husband worked on base. And now her parents, too, who used to protest outside the bases, now they felt more ambivalently too, because of her involvement with the base. One of her fears that she shared with me was passing the protesters outside the base. And she was terrified that they would see her with her Okinawan face in her car, which had a U.S. military plate on it, and that they would turn on her, attack her, call her a traitor. And this never happened, but it would happen in her mind. So for a lot of the women I met, the U.S. bases had some kind of effect on their identity. And this was something surprising that I found. There were women who used the U.S. military base, again, because we think of them as victims often, but they were using the U.S. military base and the American spaces that they created to express parts of themselves that they felt like they couldn't in Okinawan or Japanese society. This was especially true when it came to escaping traditional Japanese gender roles. And so Kiki was is another woman that I profile in the book. She was an Okinawan woman from Naha in her late 40s, and she worked on base doing administrative work. She had found that job when she was divorcing her Okinawan husband and needed a new career to support herself and her four kids. So I'm going to read a little bit about Kiki. Entering the base world, Kiki discovered she preferred an American-style workplace. The pay was good, and she could take leave whenever she wanted. She felt less stress. Japanese employers, she thought, wanted to control their workers too much. And women always have to get drinks from men, she said. At age 19, she had worked part-time for the prefectural government and, along with other young women, had been expected to make tea for her coworkers. Some men asked her to do their personal errands. This rankled Kiki. Was serving tea and making bank deposits in her job description? Was using her time like that a good use of taxpayer money? She quit after 6 months. I was always uncomfortable working at a Japanese place, she said. The woman is under the man, always, in Japanese society, still. Although she saw younger Okinawans making progress in terms of gender equality, she thought her marriage to an Okinawan had been typical of what older women endured. Though Kiki had been working and raising four kids, her husband hadn't contributed to household work. He didn't cook rice or anything, she said. Her frustration grew until one day she shocked him by saying she wanted a divorce. Working on Futenma, she found that her male coworkers treated her as their equal. American couples she met seemed to practice mutual respect. That's why I feel so comfortable here, she said, and because I'm Christian. Kiki had been raised Christian by her great aunt, then returned to the religion after her divorce. In Japan, Christianity, with its history of persecution and small number of followers, remains on the margins, and off base, Kiki felt judged for her faith. On base, she felt surrounded by people who shared her beliefs and respected all religions. So Kiki was just one woman who kind of told me these positives to working on base. I met another woman named Naomi, who had lived for 7 years in California. And so she liked working on base because she said it allowed her to express all aspects of her identity in this fluid way. She said, my personality fits to the American culture sometimes. My perspective changes almost every day. I'm creating my own style. And then there are the women known as Amejo, and these are women who only want to date American men, often just one race or another. And that's mostly a derogatory term, Amejo, but I did meet some women in Okinawa who were kind of reclaiming this term for themselves and wearing it with a sense of pride. These women form a kind of subculture in Okinawa, often transforming themselves. So the way they speak, the way they act, how they spend their time, and kind of attempt to be more American. So they might dress a little more overtly sexy than other Okinawan women. They might act a little more outspoken and be less concerned with what others think of them. In the book, I profile one woman named Eve, who was an Okinawan receptionist who was on a mission to find a Black American husband before she turned 30. And she didn't speak much English. And so, you know, there were sometimes I wondered, did she really want a partner, or was she chasing this idea, this fantasy of who a Black American serviceman is? And, you know, her story definitely felt problematic to me and connected to American ideas of race and racism. But at the same time, I kind of, as I spent more time, I saw something maybe deeper was going on there. Some Okinawans told me they felt especially connected to American service members of color because of a shared experience of facing discrimination from the dominant population. So in the case of Okinawans, Japanese people, in the case of the service members from white Americans. And this is something that the renowned Okinawan photographer Mao Ishikawa documented just after the Vietnam War in Okinawa. Mao worked in a base town bar, and during that period, there was also a Black Panther hangout. And these are some of her photos. So working at that bar, Mao said she found that she felt more comfortable with black men than with Okinawan men. She thought the men treated her more as their equal, and later she realized her bond was with these men was about their shared struggles. And I'm going to read a little bit from Mao. Have you all heard of Mao Ishikawa before? Yeah. Yeah, I was lucky to meet her and interview her in Okinawa. So Mao had started out wanting to photograph American soldiers, but realized the Okinawan women working in the bars were more interesting. On a small island that could feel socially claustrophobic, these women managed to be free-spirited, uninhibited. They didn't care when prejudiced family and friends judged them for hanging out with, dating, loving black men. The women enjoyed their lives, enjoyed their bodies, enjoyed sex unapologetically. In this, Mao recognized a more extreme version of herself, and she felt overwhelmed by their way of life. To her, these women were like akabana, the beautiful red flower that grows everywhere in Okinawa, the one you picked if you didn't have money to buy a bouquet when you visited a grave. She decided to follow their example, care even less what others thought. There are those who look down on women who work at military bars, she writes in the 2017 collection of these photos. They assume that the women are prostitutes. That is a total misconception. The bar girls were living their lives to the fullest. So again, here are these Okinawan women who are using the US military base in some way to express a part of themselves that they felt like they couldn't otherwise. So while many of these Okinawans are choosing to interact with the US military base presence, right, of course there are others who are fighting to end the US military base presence. And this is me with an Okinawan activist named Suzuyo Takazato, who I profile in the book. And one of the things that she's doing is leading an effort to document all cases of US military sexual violence against women since the end of World War II. And what she and her group are doing is they're putting together this list of crimes, and it's just incident upon incident, most of them not leading to any legal consequences, and reading through them really makes a strong impression. It gives the sense of this everyday horror of a place and time where gang rapes seemed as common as collecting sweet potatoes. And I'm going to read just a little sampling from that from a couple days in 1946. April 6, 1946. Around noon, a 19-year-old woman returning from her work in the potato field is threatened by four GIs carrying guns who carry her into the tall bushes nearby and gang rape her. April 7th, 1946, a 26-year-old woman returning home after the potato digging work is carried off in a GMC military truck to an air raid shelter where she is gang raped by six GIs. April 7th, 1946, a 28-year-old woman in Shuri City is talking with her husband after dinner when three GIs break into the house, hold down the husband, and gang rape the woman. So evidence like this shows that sexual assault by U.S. service members has long been a problem in Okinawa, especially during those war and occupation years when Okinawan lacked rights. In that situation, soldiers who committed rape often faced no legal consequences for their actions, and by many accounts, sexual assault was widespread at this time. As one American witness said, GIs then had, quote, the idea that all female Okinawans were fair game for the conquering heroes. After Okinawan became a part of Japan again in 1972, American servicemen more often faced consequences for their crimes, but the issue has continued, as I'm sure many of you remember. The well-known incident in 1995 when three servicemen brutally gang-raped a 12-year-old girl in Okinawa. And more recently, as I write about in the book, there was a murder in 2016 when an American ex-Marine killed a local 20-year-old Okinawan woman. So crimes like these, right, spark widespread protest against the bases, But as I found, and as Suzuyo Takasato talks about, most of these crimes remain hidden because they go unreported. So it's much more of a problem than many people know. So that's a big reason people protest, right? But there are other reasons. There's the noise pollution, environmental degradation, military and traffic accidents. I'm sure some of you recognize where this is. This is Futenma, right? Marine Corps Air Station Futenma. And it's been called the most dangerous base in the world. And I think you can see why, right? There's this busy flight line in the middle of a densely packed city. And there have been accidents. There was a helicopter that crashed onto a university bordering this base. And a piece of a helicopter recently fell onto an elementary school bordering this base, missing the nearest child by just 15 feet. So pretty much everyone agrees this base needs to close, and the U.S. and Japan have said they will, but on the condition of building another bigger base in Okinawa in the north of the island. And this is the location of that new proposed base called Ora Bay, and I'm going to read just one final section of the book from the chapter called Chie. On a bay as flat and gray as the sky, Chie Miyagi paddled out to confront the United States and Japan. It was a cold February morning in 2017, 8 years after Chie had taken me to a cave where schoolgirls like her mother, Sachiko, had toiled as nurses during the war. Now 58 years old, Chie was still a local high school English teacher and peace activist, known for extroversion, individuality, and collection of rainbow outfits and fake flowers she tucked into her hair. Her English nickname was Sunshine. On Ora Bay, her highlighter pink jacket and neon orange kayak were bursts of color, while the other 8 kayakers with her were dressed in black. All 9 had concealed their faces with hats, sunglasses, and bandanas. Together, they represented a range of ages and backgrounds, those who were young and those who were retired, those who were Okinawan and those who were from mainland Japan. We are born in different places and we have different jobs, Chie said, but our goal is one, we will protect Ora Bay. The group was called Henoko Blue and they did this regularly, paddling to where the new mammoth U.S. military base was being built in a district of Nago called Henoko on the eastern coast. The construction site was the bay, which was, for the moment at least, gorgeous and biologically diverse, home to coral reef ecosystems and the endangered Okinawa dugong, a revered manatee-like creature that grazed on rare seagrass. The U.S. military wanted to fill in the bay with 21 million cubic meters of rock, sand, and gravel and build a double runway state-of-the-art behemoth. The landfill work had resumed recently after a hiatus with a crew drilling for survey work and dropping concrete blocks into the water. Henoko Blue's mission for the day was to slow or stop any scheduled construction. Chie's larger mission was to end the U.S. military presence in Okinawa. She, like the other kayakers, was willing to risk her life to achieve it. Okay, so that's Chie that day that I went out with her on the water as she was protesting. Here's some of the other kayakers. And so these folks are going out there pretty much every day. And they told me that the Japanese Coast Guard, who's there patrolling the water, often gets violent with them. So they've held their faces in the water, flipped their kayaks, choked them. But they feel so strongly about this that they keep going out there. And of course, there's many other Okinawans and others who are on land protesting this base. They set up a sit-in right in front of the gate so that they're trying to block the construction site trucks from coming on base to bring like that sand and gravel to fill in the bay. Many of these Okinawans are elderly who lived through the battle. They're survivors of that war, and that is a big contributor to why they feel so strongly about this. They want a demilitarization of their island. Here's the fence there. They block the cars from leaving base. And then they have the hired security come out every so often and remove them. And so they've told me that people get injured that way as well. As I'm sure many of you know, right, this situation is still going on today. The Okinawan government is locked in a legal battle with the federal government to stop this construction. But so far, the base building is going forward, and they've started dumping that sand and gravel into the bay. But this last photo to me shows the complexity, some of the complexity of this issue. This is this woman in the green jacket is a protester who was there that day that I was there, but she stopped protesting for a minute to talk to her friend who was in Okinawan who worked on the base. So, you know, she's there fighting to close these bases, but she knows that at the same time that will mean the loss of a job for her friend and for many others. And so, you know, these are the kinds of complex relationships and feelings that Okinawans can have towards the U.S. military presence. And to me, this photo also shows, you know, we see these fences surrounding the bases, and it seems like two very distinct places on and off base. But like all borders, they are porous, and there are these relationships and exchanges constantly happening between these two places, and that's the kind of complexity that's at the heart of this story. So, thank you.
I think many of these contested places are complex, and once you start hearing stories from people and their truth, you can sympathize with every one of them. For example, in this picture you mentioned, okay, the man has his livelihood. That's her friend. And even though they're standing in this opposing place and the border is porous, it's still very fluid and it's almost, it can disappear any moment. I mean, not to be political, but is there a future for bases? And what do the Okinawans sort of generally view about the base? I mean, is it sustainable? Is it? Yeah, 50 years from now, 100 years from now.
Yeah, you know, I think while there's all this complexity, I think in at least at the ballots, Okinawans have made clear that they don't want another U.S. military base on their island, and they don't, you know, they want a reduction, if not complete closure of the bases. So I think. You know, 70% have said they don't want this new base. So I think the future should be a base reduction. And I think, you know, but I think at the same time that we should acknowledge that that does mean that something will be lost. And for a lot of people, it is complicated. And they might, I think one thing about Okinawa is a lot of people don't feel comfortable even talking about this issue. They won't say what they feel because they're afraid of offending someone or that it's very complicated. But I think when they go to the ballot, they have made clear, you know, we don't want this base. So I think that's kind of, you know, in the end, that's the answer that they're giving us. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. So the Japanese Self-Defense Forces does have a large presence on Okinawa as well, and so at least the anti-base activists, they include that in their protest as well. They want, you know, demilitarization of the island, which means, you know, all militaries leaving the island.
When I read your book, and I often tend to see sceneries, and especially your writing is so descriptive and vivid. And I just didn't get the sense it was a night in an American village. It was more of like a day in an American village. Because I think night has so much connotation attached to it, right? Like district, sex industry. But I just didn't get that feeling. So where'd you get the title from?
Yeah, it started out as a novel. And then, yeah, and then it was more like memoir. And then this title stuck, and my publisher really liked it and wanted to keep it. But, you know, I think a lot of it does take place at night, but I didn't want to focus on, I think we think of, oh, yeah, the red light districts and you know, yeah, bar scene. And that's definitely in the book. But it's also like, as I read from today, right, about everyday people and going to work, you know, in an office and things like that as well. But I think it's just like more evocative, right, to have that title.
It's always intimidating being the first one. thank you so much for your time today. My name is Katrina, and I didn't get through your entire book, but I read a lot of it, and a lot of it resonated with me because I'm a product of the military myself. My father immigrated from the Philippines to join the Navy. I was born and raised on military bases, mostly having lived in Guam, also an island country, and as a service member myself. And since it sounded like this was a very deeply personal project for you, I just have two questions, if I may. How did writing this book affect the way that you look at your identity now? Because you address a lot of the complexities, especially being half ethnically Japanese and half ethnically white. And second, in the course of writing this book, what did you conclude about how the U.S.-Japan relationship should manifest itself in Okinawa? You kind of addressed it a little bit with the closure of the bases, but I would love to hear additional thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, how did this affect my own identity? I think, I think it just really kind of affirmed how I feel as a mixed race person, you know, that I see the world through the lens of kind of these mixed spaces. And I felt like my personal perspective allows me to see places in a way that maybe others can't and or don't. And I think it was something I had to do for myself, this my own identity, this project. And I think I'm still kind of working it out, but it helped me arrive in my own mixed race identity somehow by saying this is a place, I think by saying these mixed places are valid or they have value. And they're not polluted, or it's not just conflict. You know, when you get people together and they clash together, and it's not just a negative place, it's also a beautiful place, and something original is created. And that's really important to me, I think. And then in terms of the U.S.-Japan relationship, I mean, I think... Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of people in Okinawa tell me, like, you know, we are not part of this. We want nothing to do with it. We just leave us alone. We even want independence again. You know, so I think ideally, you know, there would be, you know, closure of bases and just kind of let Okinawans decide for themselves what they want their future to be and, you know, support this resurgence of Okinawan culture and language and let them, you know, get back what was lost in this pressure to assimilate.
Hello, my name is Philippe Valdois. I have one comment and one question. I went a few times to Okinawa and I became interested in history of the place. And it's interesting because you mentioned the Black Panthers, and I read that Dennis Banks, who was the co-founder of the American Indian Movement, when he was 17, he went to Japan, and he grew a sense of solidarity with the people who had their identity stolen, in a way, and he felt in love with Okinawa women, and the army refused him to be married. So we went back to America. He went AWOL, and then he was in prison. And he developed his the American Indian Movement, also based on his experience. So my question was, is there still a sense of, can you find a sense of solidarity in some quarters in America for the people of Okinawa, people who feel the same, who have the similar experience? That's my question.
Thank you. Yeah. I showed those examples from, you know, the Vietnam War era, but I think it's still going on there. I think people would say there is still that sense of solidarity for some people. I mean, there's, you know, there is this idea when I was there that many people had that Okinawa women like black men, and that was kind of what people told me, and like service members would tell me that, like, with excitement sometimes, you know, like, oh, they, you know, this is a great place for me, you know. And so it's just an idea a lot of people had, you know, whatever truth there is to that. But I think, you know, some people told me it was this idea of solidarity, like we have had this shared experience of just facing discrimination and struggling against the dominant population, and so that we can come together and recognize that in each other and understand each other in a way that, you know, you can't with other people. So I still did see that going on. Yeah.
And I think there's also a long history of African-American and Japanese-American solidarity with the internment camp experience. So a lot of Japanese-Americans actually were part of the civil rights movement in late 50s, early 60s. And there were actually, two Japanese-Americans who actually joined the Black Panther movement and lived in Harlem and were very active. You know, this is propaganda, of course, but during the World War II, Japanese government tried to persuade African-Americans not to fight against Japanese as a way of saying, well, we're both, you know, victimized in America, so why are you fighting the white man's war? So there's kind of...
There's a sort of long history.
Yeah. Yeah, really interesting. I wanted to write much more about that, but yeah, it's another project for someone. Yeah.
Thank you so much. This was fascinating. What was I gonna say? I'll say one moment, just as a historian, no matter what I do, I'm inevitably working with sort of broad narratives, right? And so interacting with people on the ground and actually seeing how it really, really is on the ground is it's a very interesting kind of different thing. But I'm just curious, and I'm just curious how you met the people that you profile. Is it all friends of friends? Is it sitting in a bar and just happening to talk to somebody? I'd be interested to hear more about how that came to be.
Yeah, thanks. It was, you know, I think that's where I had the luxury of time, because I lived there for a year when I did the bulk of this research, and so I had the time to, you know, form relationships, and I think it was often, like, through other people that I met people, and, you know, I started small and just like a snowball or, you know, concentric circles that radiated out, so I met people, and they introduced me to people and introduced me to people, so I think that allowed me to, you know, have the type of relationship that I needed to have people open up to me with these personal stories. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi. I haven't read your book, but I'm very interested in the topic. My father-in-law was born in Okinawa, and there are many Okinawan Americans, as you know, in California and Hawaii, and Asian American solidarity movements, whether it's labor, immigration, or whatnot. I'm curious what kind of response you've gotten to your book from any audience like that in the United States, as well as potentially anyone in Japan who's been reading it in English.
Yeah. It's been interesting because I feel like the most responses I've gotten actually from the U.S. military community in Okinawa, and that was surprising to me because, you know, I think in the end I think there should be a base reduction, and but that's, people there have reached out to me saying, like, thank you for this book, and it has helped me understand Okinawa, and I think this is a book, you know, service members need to read in Okinawa. So that was surprising to me because I wasn't the audience I was necessarily imagining, but I'm also really glad to hear that, and I'm you know, if I can help with some of that understanding on the island, that's wonderful. So I haven't heard as much from Okinawan Americans yet about the book.
Yeah, and in Japan, I guess it's only in English, right?
Yeah, it is going to be translated. Sold it. So, yeah, I expect I might hear more at that point.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, I wasn't going to ask this, but I guess I will.
Yeah.
I was living in Japan in the early 1990s when the organized rape of the 12-year-old girl made headlines. At the time, it was framed as an abnormal one-off that does not happen in Okinawa. And then listening to you just now, it occurred to me, you seem to be suggesting from 1945 all the way up until the early 70s, it was not an abnormal one-off situation, that it was actually quite normal. I was wondering if this was a question that you posed to any of your interviewees more often than not, and if there's been any real research at all as to how serious a problem that was.
Yeah, thanks. Well, I think this activist group that I mentioned, Okinawa Women Against Military Violence, they are doing the research into this issue, and so they're combing through old newspapers, memoirs, police accounts, like every kind of source that they can find to try to document every instance of sexual violence, and it's, by far fewer than the actual, and they say we shouldn't focus on the actual number because it's just a small fraction. There are many, many more. So, I just read those were three from a two-day period. And those are the only reported ones. So I think, this group is doing the research, but I think it's still something that many people don't know about or don't realize. And part of it is because the vast majority go unreported today still of sexual assault. And some service members who have been arrested for these crimes have admitted that they know that they knew that in Japan sexual assault is rarely reported, and that helped lead them to commit a crime because they felt like they could get away with it. And so I think part of this movement is, trying to change society so that women can feel comfortable coming forward to report it. And this activist, Suzuyo Takazato, said, if everyone could come forward and report the sexual violence that's happening, there's no way the bases could exist under this avalanche of people reporting rape in Okinawa.
And I think, I don't want to undermine the number of rape that went in Okinawa as well, but I think in occupied territories, and especially in the country that has lost, it is unfortunately a common phenomena. Even during occupied Japan, the mainland as well, was it something like between August 30th, for the landing of MacArthur till end of September 1945, there were reported cases of 3,000 criminal cases from the GI personnel to Japanese citizens, both women and men. I think there was about 80 reported cases of rape, and this is even with RAA open, where there was confrontation, state-sanctioned confrontation. So, but then, given that it's a very patriarchal society where virginity and purity of woman's chastity was still prized, and Okinawa especially, so that's the dirty secret about Okinawa. Okinawa is a very patriarchal society. Women will probably less likely to report rape. So I think Deuce, one of the scholars, has said that it's probably triple the number of unreported cases of rape. So we were talking about a month in occupied Tokyo and Kanazawa area. So 1,500 cases of rape, and then multiply that by 12, and multiply that by 6.
Yeah, and so many activists or people would say, Okinawa still is in many ways like an occupied territory, and so that some service members might feel they're above the law still, even though they shouldn't be.
Yeah, I'm Hiroshi Meguro, and I'm a freelancer, and I cover Okinawa mainly, and so I'm very much impressed with your presentation. I haven't read your book yet, and unfortunately, so I cannot make many comments on the book, but I'm very much impressed with your very balanced observations, and as you mentioned at the beginning, a lot of books about Okinawa are a bit biased or slanted, and some books focus on one aspect of the very complicated picture. And so in that sense, I am very much impressed. And I have some comments, and I'd like to ask a question, but I can't organize the question very well yet. And so I don't know what happened to my question. But my comment is a Well, situations in Okinawa quite depend on the area, you know. And for instance, the main island of Okinawa has a lot of American bases, but in the other islands mostly don't have any American bases. But in the western part, southwestern part of the island chain, Ishigaki and Miyako and Yonaguni now have some bases of self-defense forces. And things are a bit changing gradually. But still, for instance, in the even inside the main island of Okinawa, the southern part, Itoman and others don't have any American bases, but they have some memoirs and so on, and some how to say, it's a bit historical, you know, sites, kind of cliffs and so on and so forth, and or some parks, and or museums, but they don't have any bases, and so some people say that they have very abstract idea about peace, you know, in a way, vis-a-vis current situation, you know, because you know, historically, the southern part is a really very tragic area, tragic region, and a lot of people were killed out there. But they don't have any bases anymore, except self-defense force, Air Force Base and in Naha. And so they're quite progressive or, in a way, conservative in their memory. Their memories are kind of fossilized. And so they are anti-base. But they don't have very clear vision at all or clear evidence about their feelings. You know, that's one of the situations in the region. And another case is Yomitanson. Yomitanson doesn't have any marine base, but they have a Green Beret base and some communication units. But Yomitanson is a liberal, has a liberal mayor, and he joins anti-base group, so-called All Okinawa. But he tries to establish a very good relations with the Green Beret and communications unit. And so so he's a kind of his actions are really subtle and very difficult. Sometimes he's bashed by the leftist and so forth. So it depends on the area. Yeah. That's one comment. And I try to ask a question about the it's like a broad question, but recently Hong Kong has a lot of problems, right? And a lot of people, particularly security experts, talked about the deterrence. Particularly they have China in mind. And the Okinawans traditionally are pro-China, but actually in detail, if you observe, Okinawans, probably Okinawans' ties with Taiwan are much stronger than mainland China, you know. And so some intellectuals in Okinawa started worrying about the relations between mainland China and Taiwan. And Taiwan has very close tied with Okinawa, and some Okinawans have started worrying about China's very heavy-handed approach to Hong Kong. Hong Kong is not the part of the picture Okinawans have so far, but gradually changing. But do you see any China factors? Culturally, China has a lot of impact on historically on Okinawa, but do you see any feelings about China among Okinawans?
Yeah.
I haven't organized my question very well.
No, thank you so much. China was a big topic there, and I found it really split what people would tell me about China, depending on how they felt about the U.S. military-based presence. So tended to be people who supported the presence more. They told me, we need the bases here because of China, right? If the bases leave, China will come in and fill that space. And so we'd rather have the U.S. military here than China coming in and taking over. And that was an idea I heard a lot, especially on the bases, among Okinawans who worked on base or also from U.S. service members. And then the anti-base activists would tell me, Chie, one thing she told me, she said, I'm not afraid of China. China never invaded us, took our land, occupied us. Yeah, Japan and the United States did that. We're already living that. So we're not afraid of China. The former governor, I think when I was there, was working to have stronger relations with China and also really boost the tourism industry for Chinese tourists. A lot of businesses I met were, getting things printed out in Chinese and, trying to welcome that business. I think it really depended on who was talking about China the way that they saw it.
Thank you so much for your talk. I learned a lot from that. I'm a student from Tokyo International University, and I'm majoring in international relations. So I'm very interested in some political aspects from your book. So you mentioned that people who involved in the protests are mostly elderly. So do you think that after this generation of like elderly protesters, the anti-base sentiment will no longer exist? And if yes, like what are they doing to remain the anti-base ideology to the next generations? Why we can see now like the young generations are feeling more connected to the American culture? And do you have any idea about how children in Okinawan schools are learning about the situation, learning about the military base? Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. That's a great question. So. That was a concern that some people brought up to me, that they think, because the anti-base activists are more elderly, that it's just a matter of time before it dies out. And people said the one issue was that, as you mentioned, what students learn in school, so because the curriculum is nationalized, that there's not a lot of Okinawa history that's taught in schools in Okinawa, and so they might learn about the war, but they don't learn about everything that happened after the war, so they don't know about that reversion movement that I mentioned, how all these bases came to be there, that people were forcibly removed from their land, that troubled history that I talked about. A lot of younger Okinawans don't know about it. And so people pointed to that as an issue, and that maybe, if more younger Okinawans learned about their history, they might get involved more in this issue. There were some young people I met who I include in the book who are involved in the anti-base movement, and one said there's like 12 of them on the island, and they all know each other. But so I think it is a real issue that people are grappling with, and I think part of it I thought was that this fear of being able to talk about this issue that people felt because they were afraid of offending someone. So if they had a job, they didn't want to get political and potentially offend someone, or they didn't want to offend their neighbors. And it's the older generation who is retired and who doesn't care anymore, can do what they want and say what they want. So my hope is that, somehow people feel more comfortable talking about it. And so that, a wider range of voices can get involved in the issue. But I think, we're going to see what happens there. But that was a concern of people that I met. Yeah.
Oh, hi, and thanks for the talk. I'm Adam Tompkins. I'm a historian that looks at social movements. And I too noticed that a lot of times when you see these anti-base protests, that they tend to be elderly people. But in the recent climate strike here in Shibuya, that it was very youth-oriented, and that it was this mix of Japanese students and international university students, and that was a really interesting a contrast. And knowing that military bases are huge polluters, right? And in Okinawa with the Agent Orange, how did that come out in your discussions with people? How much did they address Agent Orange and noise pollution or other types of toxics, maybe fuel spills? And then do you see, if you were to look into the future, which is hard, right? Do you see a merging or a branching out of the peace movement to try to incorporate these environmental concerns? Thank you.
That's a great question. I know, surprisingly, I didn't hear people talking about that issue, and I'm not sure if it's a lack of awareness or I don't know, but I mean, there's a journalist, John Mitchell, who's done a lot of reporting on this issue, and as you mentioned, there is a major problem with you know, contaminated groundwater and you know, Agent Orange and these other toxic substances left behind from the Vietnam War, and you know, people documented medical problems on and off base. But you know, then I read a lot about it, but when I was there, nobody was talking about it at all. And I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I drank the water too, and I but. Yeah, so I mean, in terms of the new base, there's definitely a lot, an environmental movement around that. And there's one activist who told me he's taking the environmental stance because he felt like that's what the global community might care about the most, more than like, you know, indigenous people's rights or something, that it was, you know, these, the endangered species that are going to get hurt from this base. And so they were filing a lawsuit actually, I think on behalf of the dugong, the manatee, like creature, that has the home in this bay, against the U.S. military, I believe. So he's taking that route as a kind of a strategic way to get the international community's attention. There's also like this great irony because there's this biodiverse forest in Okinawa that was nominated to be a World Heritage Site. But it's also home to jungle warfare training center for the U.S. military, and U.S. military aircraft fly over this area. So they're trying to highlight that great irony that this is, you know, an incredible natural resource with all these endangered and endemic species that some undiscovered, and yet that, you know, part of the forest is getting bulldozed for the U.S. military use. So I think there's still a lot of room for the wider public to be kind of aware of these issues and concerned about them. But some people are working in that space.
Sorry to come up to the mic a second time if I'm not like monopolizing or anything. I also neglected to introduce myself earlier. My name is Travis Seifman. I'm a postdoc researcher at the University of Tokyo, and I study early modern Okinawan history. So I'm curious, as the conversation has gone on, you know, obviously, as people are engaging with sort of everyday conversations, everyday life about family and work and about whatever, it might not come up. But I'm curious, within all of these conversations, what did the people that you interacted with have to say? I mean, did it ever come up to talk about the Ryukyu Kingdom, to talk about their connection to culture, history, tradition, you know, a history and a tradition and a culture that is ostensibly, you know, different from Japan, that it used to be a completely independent kingdom, and, you know, what does that mean to people in connection with these issues?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it really varies. I think some Okinawan people just say, I'm Japanese, right? And they feel Japanese. And others are really working to preserve Okinawan culture and language and you know, bring it back and save it and really identify with that history. So it was very varied. But I think, but part of, I think, the anti-base movement is like also this kind of mythology about Okinawan history, and that it was a, you know, a peaceful kingdom, and that, you know, they need to, yeah, you know, that that should, you know, it's worse to have the military there because of this peaceful past, you know, which is, you know, up for debate. But I think it's sometimes used in that kind of strategic way. But then, I mean, there are other people who just who feel very passionately about it. And as I mentioned, to the point where they want an independent Ryukyus again. So, but I think it's, yeah, that's, I mean, I felt conflicted even in the book, like, do I call everyone Okinawan? Because some people don't identify as Okinawan, they identify as Japanese. And, you know, how do you know how somebody wants to identify there? You know, I can't know that. So I think it's really individualized.
My mother's, on my mother's side, there's a family that were exiled from, well, not exiled, really, but they were actually part of the royal family who came when the last king was, I guess, dethroned, and they were forced to move to Tokyo. The family was actually part of that group. And they do have very traditionally Okinawan name, Gima, part of the royal family. But I think their attitude is, now that the kingdom has been lost, I mean, this particular family anyways, they became more Japanese than any Japanese we know. They've assimilated, they never gone back to Okinawa. I think their idea is, this is who we are, we need to make a home here. But then it's just one family. And then the other, there's, I guess, a branch family of that family that wanted to have the kingdom back. So I think it just varies according to, so whether they have nostalgia for the beautiful kingdom, the peaceful kingdom, or being realist and saying, this is our new home. We've been exiled.
And I heard there was a huge outpouring. Shuri Castle, you know, just burned. And I heard that, you know, Okinawan, like, they raise a ton of money right away, you know. So I think people really show that they really value that, you know, as a symbol and of their past. And I think there is a lot of pride in Okinawa of the past, of this idea of the past, at least.
Well, I strongly encourage everyone to read this book. This is a very intelligently written book, comprehensive, phenomenal storytelling. And like I said in my introduction, Okinawa is such a complicated space, but I think Akemi's story is comprehensive without being judgmental. It's balanced. It reads quickly because it's a page turner. But at the same time, it's a very thoughtfully constructed novel, almost like a novel-like nonfiction. So thank you so much, everyone, for coming. If you have a book, a copy of a book, and you want Akemi to sign it, great. But for now, can we have a round of applause for Akemi Johnson?